Good afternoon, everybody. I'd actually written a line about this not going to be a snooze fest, second session after lunch, but I think it all fell flat in the last 20 minutes. Interesting questions on the AI panel, and then some really interesting match fixing going on during the quiz. I saw that happen. Okay, I'm sure a lot of you have seen, we have been asked to, you know, use the hashtag CMO Summit in social media posts we are using today if we are here. I'm sure a lot of you have already seen a lot of content on it, maybe from the official channel, maybe from some creators who are here, maybe some people who aspire to be creators and are talking about some people being here. If we expand the circle beyond Taj MG Road, let's take a 1 kilometer radius and you start looking for what kind of content has been created. You'll probably see a vlogger talking about you know, places to visit in Bangalore, why you should go to MG Road, why you should go to Brigade Road because of their history. You'll probably see a food blogger talking about what places to eat at. You'll probably see a couple creating cringe content. They did ban TikTok in India, but the soul of TikTok still lies somewhere in some Instagram reels. So you will see content all the time. And everybody aspires to be a content creator. Cheap internet, ever improving technology on our devices. And you know, we are always creating content. In fact, as marketing professionals, we have to somewhere keep ourselves close to this ecosystem, probably also, you know, I'm just going to ask some questions, but we have to keep ourselves close to this ecosystem, how to brand, how to talk about our products, how to look at, you know, sales using social media, using content creators. So what we'll do is we'll start with a regular format in terms of I'll ask a specific questions and two of you can answer that question. We'll start with the first one. What does a collab mean to you and what are your expectations when it comes to a collab? Can we start with Ragini?
Sure, ladies first. Okay. Thank you for giving the opportunity to the lady first. I'm from Himalaya, and at Himalaya, you know, collaboration is a cornerstone for us to really connect with our consumers in an authentic way. And collaboration is on one end starting from the Instagram influencers, beauty creators, but at the other end also collaborations with sports celebrities, with our retail partners, with even NGOs, right? And for us, it's all about how do you develop meaningful collaborations? Because for us, these collab partners are a way of extending our brand identity in a way in which consumers trust a lot more. These influencers have helped us and collaborators have helped us send across our message track, reach a wider audience, but most importantly also hold our values and systems across to the consumer. Whenever we do any collab, we measure it by three key metrics at Himalaya, right? First and foremost is it in line with our values and in line with the key message track that we want to send across? Second, we are also seeing a lot of scale being built with this, right? So is it scalable? Are we able to scale it across consumer touch points, whether online or offline? And the third, like you said rightly, how do we measure it, right? So is it moving that needle on brand recall? Is it moving that needle on the brand message track being understood by the consumer? One of the best examples that I can give is our recently launched Turmeric Serum, where we collaborated with hundreds of beauty creators, right? And these hundreds of beauty creators, one, of course, helped us reach our message track in an authentic way. But more importantly, they gave us a lot of understanding of consumer preferences and trends. An interesting fact we saw is most of these consumers who were coming for serum were first-time serum buyers. There were people who were skeptical and a little bit on the fence on using all these chemicals and actives. But once the trust of Himalaya came in, once the trust of the effectiveness of our products came in, it got them the confidence to move when the message was delivered through these authentic influencers who've used the product themselves. So this is a trust that we hold quite responsibly And we also spread it across to our collaborators. So our collaborators are, again, whether it's NGO or it's a beauty creator, they understand this trust of Himalaya and they carry forward this trust across to the consumer for us.
Sean, what does a collab mean to you? And what is your expectation when it comes to collab? You know, you can answer beyond Matrix also, like beyond Matrix, what do you think it does to your brand?
Yeah, so in the era of social media is like a rakshas, which is always hungry for content. And you got to keep feeding this animal, and all of us have been through that. So for any brand, the biggest challenge is how much content can you actually create? You know, how much, it's not about just budgets or investments, but there is a limit to what, you know, can be achieved to content creation through regular routes of creative agencies, etc. So collabs with influencers is something that has worked well for us over a period of, I've been here since Jan 23, and we've been really driving this and for, with a regional flavor. So our brand is, we focus on certain markets like Maharashtra, Karnataka, you know, Telangana, whatever. And we are a very mass brand. We have to connect with the grassroots, with the kind of price points and the products that we sell. So, you know, talking in the language of our consumer has really worked for us. There are certain challenges that we face with Instagram or any kind of social media where, you know, most people in this room think of it as English first, whereas for us, it's more of a language first, a regional language first, a vernacular first medium where we strive to, I'm not saying we get it right all the time, but we strive to, you know, connect with our audiences through these regional collaborations. And like, I'm just giving an example. Recently, there was a, you know, we did an event for one of our brands, and the influencer was, he was speaking in some, you know, like he was struggling with it. English was not his first language. He was struggling with it. And I told my team that, why are we forcing this guy to speak in English? Let him speak in Kannada. Let him speak in whatever he's comfortable in. Because our audiences connect with that. You know, it's not about being elitist. We can't afford to be with the brand that and the products that we sell.
Yeah, we have seen it in our campaigns as well, that regional influencers work really well. They take it to the they take it to an extent, they take it to geographical areas we have never imagined, and they have following even in extremely rural areas. I if you remember, there was something called a Kiki challenge some years back. There were these two guys from Telangana who did it with a buffalo, or in from Karnataka, I don't remember which place, but they did it in a rice field. Ragini did mention that they choose influencers or creators on the basis of value sets, you know, whether it matches with their brand. Aditya, how do you, for your brand, select influencers or creators for collaborations?
Yeah, thanks. I'm with McKay in a foods company, frozen foods company. A lot of you would know Smiles, which is one of our products. So, you know, apart from the standard metrics,
as Sean mentioned, chakna for the older people.
Chakna for the evening, a unique one. So, apart from the standard metrics of engagement, reach, etc., you know, what we look at is two or three things. First is, do we have synergies with the influencer or not? You know, do the values, as Ragini mentioned as well, do the influencers' values align with ours or not? You know, are they authentic? You know, since food is our category, it needs to be super authentic and a part of everyone's daily life. So that's metric one. Two is, does it add to brand trust or not? In categories like ours, you know, which is frozen foods, one of the challenges that we face is that there's a lot of noise around frozen foods as a category. People think that frozen foods have preservatives in them. A lot of noise around that. But frozen foods actually, or our products have zero preservatives in them. And so we had an influencer on board, you know, who launched one of our new products back in October. And when she launched it, she got trolled by the rakshasas of social media that, you know, how can you influence a brand, you know, which has preservatives in it? Kaise kar sakte ho? And we had no preservative. So when we launched the next campaign, which was 5 months later, you know, where we were talking about the fact that we had no preservatives, we started with that, you know, with her looking at her social media feed of being trolled, and then linking back to the fact that McKin had no preservatives at all, and that performed exceedingly well. Yeah. So two is about trust and building brand trust. Then there's the aspect of ensuring that you know it adds to our business, you know, that the partnerships are longer term. So we've made the transition last year from using influencers as tactical partners to making them brand advocates. So having a panel of influencers, you know, who are essentially brand advocates who can build our brand over a period of time. So, you know, we've made the shift from treating it as a tactical sales driving tool to more of a long-term strategic partnership.
I think all of us have been trolled at some stage on social media, despite of the fact that none of us are influencers over here. Imagine if an influencer with a million followers comes up with an opinion, definitely there's going to be a counter opinion somewhere, which may not be true most of the times. Most of the times it is also ill-informed. People do not put facts over there. People just end up trolling you for the sake of it, because trolling also gets you followers. So a hack, if you troll people, you might actually become content creator. We did mention, Ragini again did mention that, and even Aditya, you know, in terms of how a success of a collaboration is measured. Nitin, can we look at just numbers? Do you look at just numbers? Do you look at anything beyond that? And if you look at numbers, what are those specific numbers you are looking at when you define a collaboration as successful?
Yeah, so do I look beyond numbers? Yes. I think first thing that I look at is my CEO and my boss happy with the collaboration? I think that's a good yardstick.
The WhatsApp group thumbs up?
WhatsApp group thumbs up, number of WhatsApp group thumbs up. I boss GRPs, yeah. No, but jokes apart, I think, so for us, given the category that we play in, and Aqua's a insurtech brand, right? We don't look at influencers or collaborations with creators from a short-term sales goal at all, right? Because ours is not an impulsive purchase that you will be able to get, right? So, you know, like if this session is about influence, right? I think what we truly look for in terms of any partnerships that we do with content creators or collaborations that we do with them is influence that they can bring. Right now, obviously, influence is very difficult to quantify, right? So, but a couple of metrics that we do look at is, so like we use influence at various stages, right? One is at a brand level, the other one is at a product level, right? The product level ones are a little easier to gauge. Like for example, if you were to go into the Aqua app, you'll see a bunch of bite-sized videos that we've done with our chief content collaborator that we have, that's with Madhavan, the actor, right? And then we use him in different ways. So small bite-sized videos that are in our app during the product journey, that is easier to quantify in terms of how that piece of content, that collaboration is influencing people to move from one step of the journey to the other, right? What we are planning at more like a brand level, I think is difficult to quantify. I think our brand tracks do throw some light, you know, in terms of some of the mind measures that you wanted those collaborations to move, have they moved in the right direction or not? But like you do take brand tracks with a pinch of salt also, so.
I really like that answer as an agency which gives influencers. When I come to you with a campaign, you say it will be, it's easy, it's not easy to quantify is what I'm expecting from you. Soumitra, what about Meesho? How do you guys look at a collaboration like successful in terms of whatever you do? Because Meesho is also an e-commerce platform. So there are various things happening at a given point of time in various product categories.
Awesome. So for us, I think there are three different kinds of collaborations that we do with influencers, right? The first one is to look at them as a combination of content as well as distribution device, right? So for example, if you have an influencer who has a certain X million following, they are giving you their credibility and influence, and as well as they're giving you distribution, right? Which is partially the case for celebrities in ads, right? So when you make, you have to make the content, you have, they only lend their face, but then you have to go and distribute, right? And all of these tier of collaborations are largely reach-led. They are led on metrics of cost per reach, cost per impression, cost per view, and whether or not that collaboration actually landed in the territory and corner of internet that we wanted to land is an input metric. Is a selection metric higher? We need to choose this this influencer because they hang in that corner of the internet, right? And whether that collaboration was successful qualitatively, we look at comments. So you do a sentiment analysis of the comments of that collaboration and you get to know whether people are feeling what they want to feel or not. The second tier of collaboration is to use mid and mega influencers and collaborate with them on a decentralized sort of distribution plus content theme, right? Which is where I think Paragon example was quite relevant, what Sean said. You go to the top people for their big distribution, you go to the mid people for their local relevance, for their local credibility. I was in Varanasi recently and I met this girl, Vidhi, she's preparing for CA, and she doesn't follow any of the influencers that maybe all of us follow for investment advice or learning chartered accounting. She follows somebody from Lucknow who's also was preparing for CA and then became a topper and then started making content, right? So that gave me a good insight ki, achha, she has much more trust on this guy versus, let's say, Asharan or somebody out there who's really big right now. The third level, and this is where I think I would disagree with part of the panel, is that, and maybe fortunately it's possible for e-commerce, that creators are now monetizing their content. And something like an e-commerce industry is completely integrated in that process. In fact, within Meesho, we consider content commerce to be the next e-commerce, right? And that is the biggest opportunity as well as the biggest threat out there if we don't tap into it and if we don't move fast. So at any month, we have micro influencers who are making content, acting as the sales machinery of Meesho, bringing certain X percentage revenue to Meesho. And for that service, they are by design and rightfully taking a commission based on the content that they make, and that's how they're monetizing. Like in, today we have influencers who have as low as 2,000, 3,000 following, making great Meesho hauls and Meesho finds content, and they're just putting a link, or they have automated this, that if you just go and comment link in the DM, you'll get the link of the product, which is a Meesho link in your Instagram DM, right? So that's how three different levels and three different types of measurements.
The chartered accountant girl you met, she shouldn't be on social media. She will not be able to clear CA. I'm a chartered accountant. I know this. She actually shouldn't be on social media. If you're in touch with her, just call her up and say, stop following everybody on social media.
Maybe she's a CA with aspirations of becoming a content creator.
Yeah.
You never know.
Ragini, would you like to talk about any specific campaigns by Himalaya where you were able to differentiate yourselves, like your brand, and give us maybe we can talk a little bit about the collaborations, like what kind of influencers we used over there and what kind of content was created around that?
So quite a few collaborations that we do, but if you were to talk about the one there where we've done an extensive collaboration, right? Like the way I was talking, we collaborate with all sorts of people, influencers and beauty creators being one, but the other is also a lot of organizations and NGOs, etc. And this,
yeah, you mentioned
example
NGOs,
is,
yeah, just like, yeah? A little light on that, yeah. Because I've never heard this before, being in this industry.
Yeah, I said. So there are, I'll give you two examples. One where we've been collaborating for quite a few years with an NGO called Smile Train. This is for an initiative which we call Muskan. We do operations, surgeries for kids with cleft lip, and our intent is to bring smile on every kid's face. Right. So this is before the word influencer and collaboration, etc., became popular. And we've been doing it year on year, and we've While it's usually people call it CSR, for us it's much beyond that, right? For us and for SmileTrain as a partner and a collaborator, it's really our ethos and how we are bringing a little bit of smile in everybody's face. So that's how we've continued some of the long-term collaboration. One of the other good examples of something which is turning out to be a long-term collaboration and has really helped us differentiate ourselves in the market is where we collaborated with the Women's IPL. So we collaborated with RCB, the Women's RCB team, for a campaign called Take My Spot. And this was a second year of collaboration. It works in a couple of ways. You know, I talked about values, so it really is in line with Himalaya's values, where we are collaborating with a women's team in a primarily male-dominated sports, in line with Himalaya, in line with what our consumers and audiences are actually talking today, in line with my personal ethos as a sports person, playing cricket actually in a male-dominated world. So very close to my heart. We got quite a good success with the first year of collaboration also last year, where we were talking about a not fair campaign, where we were trying to bust the barrier of inclusivity about facial skin. But this year we did a lot of collaborations, right? So one was of course with RCB, where we collaborated with the star players, Smriti Mandana, Richa Chadda, Richa Ghosh, as well as Shreyanka Patil. But this time we also collaborated with a content creator, Danish Seth, right? And the reason we did that is it was very much in line with the way we wanted to bring across the messaging. We wanted to bring across the messaging in a very Gen Z, lighthearted humor way, and his way of taking a pun on the word spot itself brought in a lot of awareness, but at the same time helped us connect with a very another set of audience, right? One set of audience who's watching Women IPL, there's one set of audience who's following content creators like Danish Seth. How do we tie in all of this together? And we got great amount of success. We extended it beyond, and then we said we'll take the same campaign across to even our channel partners. And that's the place where we collaborated with the likes of Flipkart, where we became a part of the Flipkart Glamour event, again launching our turmeric range of serums as well as face washes and other beauty care products. And then when we went into offline, which is Reliance, we again collaborated with influencers who went into the stores, looked at the products, read the back panel, which is what is the behavior of today's consumer. They want to know everything that is in there. All of this put together, in collaboration with the hundreds of content creators that we already have on Instagram and YouTube, etc., built this huge wave of differentiation and awareness for us, our products, and definitely carried on the credibility that Himalaya always brings to the table. So if I say the breadth of the collaboration, as well as the quality of collaboration, are two that really helped us differentiate ourselves in the market and are taking us closer to what the consumers want to see versus just what the brand wants to talk about.
When did you sponsor the RCB women's team?
During the Women's IPL.
Which year? Last year?
Last year and this year.
Maybe you should also sponsor
the
RCB men's
so
team.
That they win.
Probably. Things might change over there. I don't know if I'll go alive from here. But
so this year we've sponsored two teams. One, a big team which all of you know, which is the Women's IPL, and they won the award. And we sponsored a cricket league in my society, where there were 13 teams, and the one that we were sponsoring won. So this is a good year for us to sponsor.
So I think
men's RCB next year.
I think you'll get a lot of support in Bangalore for that. See, they're clapping. They're already supporting you. Nitin, when it comes to insurance, it's a life insurance, health insurance. It's a very complex, high trust, personal involvement product. It's never an impulsive buy. Like, main uth ke subah sochta nahi hu ki main aaj iski insurance khareedunga. So how do you look at collaborators for insurance specifically? Like, how do you choose them, and what has worked for you in the past, and what do you think will work for you in the future? Something on that.
Yeah, so like you rightly pointed out, I think the category is one which is not based on impulse. It's a well-researched buy, specifically when you come to categories like health and life insurance, right? So for us, sort of the model that we've looked at is a, like I was saying earlier, like a two-step model, right? The first one is, which is more in terms of helping us with the Uber goal of creating a bit of trust, authenticity, and credibility around the brand, right? Because let's look at two things, right? One is, it's an industry which is dominated by the big wigs of the financial world, right? Who are we? We are still a very young brand, and we are competing against HDFCs, ICICI, right? So there's a lot of equity that they borrow. We need to build that equity, right? So one leg is, like I was saying, towards this large Uber goal of building more trust and building more credibility for us as a young brand. For this, I think like one example that's worked well for us is our collaboration with Madhavan that we've been doing for the last almost 8-9 months or a little bit more now. It started off as an experiment, right, where we did not know if this was actually going to give us any result. But what we were very sure of was that it's, again, a category where the voice of the customer is very suppressed. And because of that, they typically feel inundated with this whole complex world where, like, the insurance company always has more power than you as a customer. Our rationale was, let's flip the wing, right? Let's get him on board more as what we call internally as the voice of the customer. Now, what does the voice of the customer do? All the things that you wish you could ask or you could get a clarity on, he represents that voice and he gets it straight to us as an insurance company, right? So whether it is, what do I need to do right so that at the time of claim, my claim is not rejected? What's the right way to look at the value of the car that you are insuring, right? So all of these things which help them navigate, demystify this complex jargonish world of insurance, he's played a very large role in terms of giving people, like indirectly giving people the confidence that as a company, we are actually on the consumer's side because we care to answer and we care to give voice to the questions that the consumers otherwise would struggle to answer. The second one is, like a little bit down the funnel, if I were to look at the classical marketing funnel, where we do look at a lot of influencer partnerships in the consideration phase. For example, where our ads actually stop, right? And they've done a fairly good job in terms of creating intrigue or interest in our products. But because the kind of category that it is, people look for a lot of validation before they actually take the step. It's a relationship that they're entering where the payoff will happen maybe 20, 30, 40 years down the line. In most cases, when you are not there in this world, right? So how do you trust a brand to, how do you get validation in that sense, right? To take the next step, get us to be a part of their consideration set and then probably move up further. Which is where I think a lot of collaborations at scale that we've done, and to borrow from what Sean and what Samitra were saying, I think we've done a large bit which is at a language level, at a regional level, because for us, while we don't go too much into tier two or tier three, but even if I look at the top 20 cities in India where we focus on to build our customer base, there is a lot of inbound queries that we see. For example, YouTube, right? Like number two or number three search term for us on YouTube is ACO health insurance review in Canada, right? So how do you make sure that you are actually present at that zero moment of truth as well when somebody is actually looking for more validation? And that's the second model that's worked wonderfully well for us.
We can say Danish State is the biggest influencer in Karnataka. Can we say that, guys?
If you're excluding politicians, then maybe yes.
Sorry?
I'm saying if you're excluding politicians and maybe a certain Mr. Kohli, then maybe yes.
How many of you know Sam Samir? students are sitting here, other than, oh, he's a very big influencer in Kannada. I just thought I would ask. Soumitra, if you've done any campaigns which are for your brand completely in collaboration space with influencers, for the complete brand, and if you've done it for any category, and if you would like to share some examples, whether those campaigns worked for you or they did not work for you, please share with us.
Good. I'll actually share a very different kind of model that we use, which in itself is a campaign. What happens with Meesho is, if we go out and collaborate with a certain set of, like I was saying, the mid-tier and mega influencers, and we tend to create an IP with them, that IP then gets adopted by other micro influencers because they are looking up to these people as for guidance, right? So we have done this 3 times, once very successfully, another 2 times with moderate success, and a lot of iterations and failures in between. But if you go on YouTube and just type hashtag Meesho Halls, you will see, and if you just go to the back end of YouTube and see that data, every month there is at least more than 10,000 videos getting made on that one hashtag, which is people ordering a bunch of things from Meesho and then making t-shirts under 500, kurtis under 700, ka pura ek showcase. Just changing, and it's a long format video that keeps happening, right? Now, what does this do for the brand is that when we want to create an IP to stand for something, Meesho Hall stands for great variety at right prices. So many t-shirts at X number of price. And that was by design the content that was seeded upfront and paid for, partly on based on content deals and partly on commissions. And then was adopted by other micro influencers because they realized that if they use this hashtag, their discovery of that particular video is much higher than the normal video, right? And then we came back and did it again with something called Meesho Finds. And because we were coming up with home decor as a category and that is growing, and we wanted to create an IP for that. So if you go and search for Meesho Finds on YouTube or Instagram, you'll find a lot of quirky products that you can use either for home decorations or cleaning or kitchen tools or some appliances tools and so on, all of which are in this life hack sort of territory. So the content that worked for that was that, hey, trouble cleaning two-sided windows, here's the mob that does it. And that kind of content, you know, started becoming viral with the sort of like the mega influencers first, and then that flywheel got created, right? So similarly, let's say if tomorrow we have a challenge, today we have a challenge of being more relevant and more resonating with Gen Zs as an audience, and make Meesho the preferred e-commerce destination for them. We're developing an IP called Meesho Trends, which showcases latest trends at the right prices, and we're following a similar model. So I think that is something that fantastically worked for us. Seed and then withdraw, and then see the flywheel rotate by itself.
Interestingly, a lot of organic content is also made on that, which is not related to Meesho.
Yes.
Where people, a store in Thane is like, 50 ka maal hai leke jao, and they start using that content. I've seen it recently, and people have millions of views on it, on Instagram, on YouTube.
Yeah.
People are creating organic content because it gets searched, and then if you are from Thane, or if you are, say, from some specific part of a city, you will start looking for those stores as well. So you're helping small businesses. That could be a tagline.
That is the mission of Meesho. Yeah.
Recently, I was on the McCann page and I saw a collaboration with another brand, Wingreens. Like, it was a food brand again. I don't know if it's necessarily a competitor, but how do you think that has worked for you, Aditya? Is it the way for other brands to go, where you collaborate with other brands, maybe not in the same space, because that possibly is not going to happen. But when two brands collaborate with each other on a common goal, on a common festival or something, does that work for the brands?
As most marketers say, it depends. But, you know, just talking about McCain's context and what McCain has been through, see, we're a small category. Frozen foods is a very nascent category in the country, and it's the adoption is moving up. So before COVID, the only kind of brand collab that we used to do was with a mithai wala frying french fries outside the shop and sampling it to people, because that behavior didn't exist. Now what happened after COVID was that everyone became a chef, right, in COVID, and category adoption suddenly moved up. And after that, now what we're looking at, you know, is that if we find synergies with brands where, you know, we can enter into households together and have win-win propositions that exist, then the partnership makes a lot of sense for us. So complementary brands across the food and beverage category, like the brand that you mentioned over here, and a lot of other brands that we partner with as well. Recently, part of a marketing strategy, we pick certain occasions and activate them. You know, we recently activated the monsoon occasion because apparently chai and pakoda is a big thing, right, across some parts of the country. So chai and McCain was the partnership you were talking about, and we got some brand banter going and lots of reach which came through from that. So that's the online piece. We also do a lot of offline partnerships with complementary category brands like Wingreens and a lot of others, and also brands which operate in the space of the kitchen. So appliances brands, you know, which can help us enter into new households and help those brands enter into new households. We keep looking for opportunities and keep activating those.
This was a very specific question with the regional influencers. I think Paragon has done a lot of work with regional influencers. You did mention that it is easier to connect with the audiences. And can you give us examples of campaigns which you've done in various parts of the country with different languages and different creators, and how it has worked for you, and what product categories you were trying to sell through that, like trying to brand through that?
So, you know, it's a biggest nightmare for a marketeer to derive the ROI for this influencer marketing bit, and we've all, I'm sure everyone on the stage has struggled with it. How do you justify it? Maybe Meesho can, but the rest of us are in a quandary most of the time. The most unique example, and while everyone was sharing, I just thought of this example. Quite a few months back, there was a particular, some guy made a video in Kerala. Okay, I'm forgetting which town of Kerala, but made a video with a pair of white slippers. White chappals is kind of mostly used during the rains. I don't know what made it go viral. We were all scratching our heads. But we sold out that slippers in Kerala, in that market. We sold it out. Matlab, it was a non-moving stock. And it became such a nightmare for me.
You should have just taken credit for it. Said, maine karwaya.
I mean, no. So, I mean, maybe I'm too, you know, honest or whatever. My boss actually sent it to me. My director sent it to me, like, who did this? And he said, like, make more of these. Like, aisa banao. You know, like in every market, we should do this. But you don't know what will go viral and what won't, you know. And you mentioned something about Thane, and, you know, so we have several retailers who have their own Insta handles and Facebook pages, mostly Insta. They make these random videos. Ki ye bik raha hai, aao kharido, some crap like that. And, you know,
ye chappal tootegi nahi, kuch karo.
And, you know, when we wonder, yaar, kya hai? There's no strategy, nothing behind it, and it just goes, they get crazy response. The engagement is through the roof. Like, you can't pay enough for that kind of engagement, and they actually do good business. So, I mean, I think we are all grappling with the fact that what works and what doesn't work. And this is from my entire experience as a marketer from the time we've been doing digital marketing. This whole concept of, I hate this sentence when anybody says, ek viral video banao.
That's the brief we get most of the time.
I feel like throwing something at people who say that, ek viral video banao. Kya hota viral video? What the hell is a viral video? Exactly. Maybe if I throw that and, you know, wo ha chappal fekunga, like, you know, that happened to George Bush at one point. There is no such thing as a viral video. I mean, there's content which goes viral and most of us don't even know why it happens. And some really, really, sorry to use the word, shitty content gets viral. We don't know why. And something it doesn't. The best of creatives don't go viral. So, we are all grappling with the same problems. So we try and, so this is, these are two examples. And yeah, I mean, coming to a planned campaign, these are all unplanned stuff, but planned campaign, like we're doing, and we're currently in talks with a media house in West Bengal to do something for Durga Puja. We've done this last year very successfully, you know, and that's fair bit of money, but you know, using regional influencers in various parts of the country to you know, talk about the connect with the brand, you know, we have a campaign, so our brand positioning is Zid Chalte Rehne Ki, and how do we connect to them with their personal experiences, their life journeys. So that's something that we did last year very successfully, and this year we are planning to repeat it, in starting with Durga Puja, probably Kerala for Onam, Ganesh Chaturthi, you know, various these festivals which bring people together, and how the brand message can be actually taken forward, you know, imbibed into the life journey of this, of these influencers. They could be celebrities, they could be minor celebrities, or you know, even mega or micro influencers, but that's the whole plan that we have in mind for this coming festive season. And that's something that's kind of worked for us. Like I said, we really don't know what works, what doesn't. My agency's creative head, he starts every stat by, you know, with this quote from, I'm forgetting which director, nobody knows anything. So I think, you know, that really clicks with me. Whenever anywhere my director asks me ki kya karna chahiye, nobody knows anything. So we'll do this. It work, doesn't work well.
So I think and super authentic, right? I think a lot of times this core struggle of making viral content is a conversation across all social media teams. And I think what you said in the beginning, cringe, I realize over time it's quite subjective. Like what is cringe for us may not be cringe for a person who's sitting somewhere in, you know, Asansol in West Bengal, for example, right? And hence, like, a very cautionary tale that we have learned over time again and again, and we remind ourselves again and again, ki you give them subtle guideline. You give them ki yaar, ek ded second ke liye achhe tarike se aap feature karna, hume ye bolna hai. This is what we want to say, right? Uske baad, aapke liye jo kaam karta hai, aap wo karo. And when you have that freedom given to, you know, that person, and then you have a deal which is very transparent on performance, then see the magic sort of happen, you know.
Yeah, I think most of the videos with creators do not go viral, probably is also because we tend to control them a little too much instead of giving them the complete freedom to do what they want to do. Obviously, that's a risky proposition because we are paying them. That's one of the reasons that we want the brand to come in, because if we are, there's a commercial transaction involved over there. So I think we will conclude like in...
Sorry, there's one thing, I have another favorite line in when agency meetings is, my agency regularly comes up with ideas which will sack me. So I call it CMO sacking ideas. And what you mentioned, giving the freedom to influencers, is something that can cost us our job, because you don't know what will go viral, but it might definitely cost you your job and your career.
Anything. I was just thinking that, Sean, you're being so authentic. I think you're on your path to being a content creator yourself.
Yeah, such honesty also works sometimes. You see on social media. So I think we will conclude this session with like one of the biggest takeaways is that Himalaya should sponsor RCB men's team. And secondly, entrepreneurs sitting out there, if you're able to find a viral video, your agency is a super hit in every brand. And I think Ritika and Simran will be very happy that we are concluding this session. Thanks a lot to all of you. Thank you for giving us insights. I would have liked the conversations to go a little more, but we were told to keep it crisp. And we did mention to Kiel, like we did at McKen's Chakna. Thank you guys. Thank you.
One round of applause to Prateek as well. Thanks for hosting, man.